Tales from the Crypt is a horror anthology film produced by Amigas Productions in the year 1972. The film is made up of five separate segments, each one having their basis in the stories from EC Comics' Tales from the Crypt, along with sister titles The Vault of Horror and The Haunt of Fear.
And then...
Director Freddie Francis, who had a history of helming horror pictures starting with Hammer Films, shot the piece over at Shepperton Studios, which fans of Star Wars will remember best for the medal ceremony at the close of the first film.
And then...
The film's framing sequence begins with five tour group members stumbling into a face-to-face sit-down with the somber Crypt Keeper, portrayed by Ralph Richardson. The Crypt Keeper, along with the other EC titles, were the brainchild of William Gaines and Al Feldstein. The Crypt Keeper was first introduced within the pages of EC's Crime Patrol, issue number 15, in the year 1949. By issue number 17, the title changed from Crime Patrol to The Crypt of Terror, and with issue number 20, the title became known as Tales from the Crypt that following year. The Crypt Keeper serves as the witty host of the comic book story, providing a prologue and epilogue to each story while making various puns or double entendre, bringing a lighter balance to the normally horrific nature of the pieces.
Who are you? I assure you, I have a purpose.
In the film, he appears hooded like his fellow hosts, collectively known as the Ghoul Lunatics, but individually known as the Old Witch, who is the host of the Haunt of Fear, and the Vault Keeper, who is the host of the Vault of Horror, as opposed to his appearance in the comics themselves. The Crypt Keeper then reveals to each member of the tour group the grisly manner in which they will meet their ultimate end, leading to our five short tales... From the Crypt.
What do you want?
To show you something.
A piece that originated in the comic pages of 1954's The Vault of Horror, issue number 35, and all through the house, features murderess Joan Clayton covering up the murder of her own husband for his life insurance policy on Christmas Eve. The role of Clayton is portrayed by Joan Collins, who is still pretty attractive here for a murderous little minx, and who not so very long ago played the innocent love interest of Captain Kirk, Edith Keeler, in the fan-favorite episode City on the Edge of Forever, and also Batman fans may recall that she was the alluring songstress Siren in the 1966 Adam West television series. So, while Clayton is busy cleaning up her messy trail of red blood with white soap, which just so happens to be the colors of Christmas cheer, she overhears a special announcement on the radio that a homicidal maniac has just escaped from the hospital for the criminally insane and is at large in the county. As she is yet to cover up the evidence of her husband's recent demise, Clayton is hesitant to call on the police when she believes the escaped lunatic is right outside her home. Much to my mother's chagrin, I'm sure, the lunatic killer is eventually let inside the home by Clayton's younger daughter because he is dressed like Santa Claus.
He's here, Mommy! I let him in! It's Santa!
My mom really hates killer Santas, what can I tell you? And if she hates that, then there's no telling how she'd feel about Jack Frost, that's for sure. You may also recognize this piece from the version that aired as part of the HBO series Tales from the Crypt in the year 1989. The television series plays this episode as a bit more tongue-in-cheek, and since it tends to play up the camp value, you may find yourself less in fear and more in stitches from the excessive laughter.
Jesus, Joseph. How many times have I asked you to lose some weight?
The next sequence, Reflection of Death, originated inside the comic book pages of 1951's Tales from the Crypt, issue number 23. Here, an adulterous father and husband, Carl Maitland, played by Ian Hendry, is seen running off with his on-the-side gal, Susan Blake. In the rush to leave their old life behind forever and start anew, the two race straight headfirst into a car crash. When he regains consciousness, Maitland tries to get a ride to his old home with little success.
You crazy fool! Do you want to get yourself killed?
Finally, making his way to his former household, he finds his wife has returned the favor and is with another man. Knocking on the door to be let inside his home, his wife simply screams and shuts the door on Maitland. Then he decides to seek out his girl on the side and fellow accident victim for more answers. He learns that the accident happened nearly 2 years ago and has left her blinded. It's only then that Maitland realizes that Haley Joel can see him.
I don't understand. How did...
I brought it back. After the crash. And I was blinded.
Blinded?
And Carl was killed.
Killed?
2 years ago.
While the essence of the original comic book story from Tales of the Crypt, issue number 23, was preserved, in the comics, it was not actually a couple having an affair who were involved in the car wreck, but two men named Al and Carl who were making a long late-night drive.
What did he see?
What's more important is what you will see.
The following segment, entitled Poetic Justice, was derived from the comic book pages of 1952's The Haunt of Fear, issue number 12. In this tale, we have a pair of elitist snobs, Edward Elliot and his son James, who have it out for a sweet old man by the name of Arthur Grimsdyke.
You may fire when ready.
What?
You're far too trusty. Dantooine is too remote to make an effective demonstration, but don't worry. We will deal with your rebel friends soon enough.
I know, you have to see sweet old Governor Tarkin to believe it.
Bye-bye, see you tomorrow. Shut the gate. Bye-bye.
Anyway, that's Peter Cushing as the kindly old man Grimsdyke, who, when not handling waste collection and management, spends his pastime entertaining children of the neighborhood and feeding his kennel of pet dogs. The father and son stop at nothing to make the old man miserable, so he will sell his property to them and leave. First, James goes after his prized pet dogs, framing them for garden vandalism.
But you mustn't take them away. They're my friends. Sergeant, please.
Following this, the two use their political influence with the mayor to not only have Grimsdyke lose his job, but also his retirement pension.
Poor old Grimsdyke. I do believe he's out of a job.
Next, he plays up their own desire to see Grimsdyke exiled from town to the parents of the neighborhood by painting Grimsdyke out to be some sort of child molester.
You can tell from looking at his house what a filthy old man he is. Constantly filling it with children. Heaven knows what his motivations are.
Fiddle them out!
Thinking then that the entire neighborhood is turned against him when he gets a bunch of hurtful Valentine cards, Grimsdyke is driven to suicide, thanks to the twisted schadenfreude of James, who is the one who actually sent all the negative Valentine cards.
She was too hefty.
A tree is beautiful if its owner prunes it, but our town isn't, because your presence ruined it. Oh. Some people live in the country. Some people live in the town. Why don't you do us a service? Jump in the river.
Evacuate? In our moment of triumph?
I think you overestimate their chances.
But not to worry, these two jerks get their comeuppance when Grimsdyk returns from the grave exactly 1 year later on Valentine's Day. He rips out James's heart and attaches the organ to a valentine sent to his father, Edward.
You were mean and cruel right from the start. Now you really have no...
After that, we come to the piece Wish You Were Here, originating from 1953's The Haunt of Fear, issue number 22. Wish You Were Here, while taken from the comics, is also self-acknowledged as derivative of W.W. Jacobs' short story, The Monkey's Paw. However, instead of the monkey's paw granting off-kilter wishes with disastrous consequences, in this tale, the object is actually an ancient Chinese figurine.
It reminds me of a tale I once read. What was it?
We could pay all our debts.
The monkey's paw. That's what it was.
I wish...
I read it when I was at school.
I wish for lots and lots of money.
Ralph Jason and his wife Enid are on the brink of financial ruin when the wife, while reminiscing over the object, decides to alleviate their economic difficulty by wishing for a grand fortune. The consequence of this wish results in the husband being killed in a car wreck.
Hello?
Enid is then told by their lawyer that her wish was made reality due to the life insurance plan taken out by Ralph.
You mustn't wish Ralph back.
Why not?
Enid tries to use the subsequent wishes to right the wrong of her husband's demise, but each wish just makes things more and more worse.
Ralph? Dead?
She decides to bring Ralph back from the dead, as he was prior to the accident. But of course, the actual cause of death turns out to be from a heart attack brought on by fear from the Ghost Rider-looking Grim Reaper he saw at his heels just before the wreck took place. She then tries to correct this failed attempt at resurrection.
Please, please. I wish Ralph were alive now. I don't want him to die ever. I want him moving, breathing, talking, alive. Now, forever.
Her good intentions pave the way to Ralph's personal hell as they find his body had been embalmed and now he will live forever but with constant pain and no way to ease his suffering.
You see, you wished him alive forever. You can't kill him. Every piece of him is alive still.
You might also recognize this piece from the episode from HBO's seventh season of Tales from the Crypt, entitled Last Respects. Here, instead of using the Chinese artifact, the monkey paw is put back into play and revolves around three sisters rather than a husband and wife. While the car crash takes the life of the youngest sister, in this piece, the middle sister actually planned the younger sister's death. The oldest sister's final wish is then bestowed upon her dead youngest sister, who is resurrected to get revenge upon the conniving middle sister.
The funny thing is, her wish was to spend a little more time with you.
The final tale, Blind Alleys, comes from the comic book story from 1955's Tales from the Crypt, issue number 46. In this last segment, we're introduced to one Major William Rogers at the Elm Ridge Home for the Blind.
Mr. Rogers?
Major Rogers.
Everyone remembers Mr. Rogers' neighborhood, but things weren't always hunky-dory in the hood.
Do you know what sharing is? Sometimes it's nice to ow. Peter, come over here, please. The train track's too close to the lake. I got a shock. Weren't we going to solve this problem?
I'm sorry. It's just that, you know, the lake is...
We're solving the problem, Peter. Solving the problem. Solving the problem. Solving the problem. And problem solved.
Rogers acts as a miserly, tyrannical Scrooge, using his background as an efficient military officer as an excuse to make extreme cuts in finance to the residents of the facility. Food and heat are both rationed while he feeds steaks to his Belgian shepherd, Shane.
And blind people are not like people with sight. We have lost one sense, but the loss of that one sense only tends to sharpen the other. Do you know what that means? We feel things more acutely. If food is bad, it tastes worse to us. If a room is dirty, we feel every speck. If an insect scurries across the floor, we hear it. And if it's cold, we feel the cold more.
When this temperature regulation leads to the death of a resident, the remaining tenants construct a basement maze filled with narrow corridors that have sharp razor blades affixed to them. The major then reaps what he's sown as the residents starve his shepherd the same way they have been starved, and give the major a taste of what it's like to live in the world of a blind man by placing him inside the razor-filled maze and then turning out the lights. Eventually, Shane is released into the maze so he may eat the hand that feeds him. You may also recognize the similarities in the episode from HBO's sixth season of Tales from the Crypt, entitled Revenge is the Nuts. The blind tenant wronged in the updated version is a young girl named Sheila, who the building director attempts to blackmail for sexual favors. When she refuses him, he withholds food and heat from her and the other residents. Of course, the retribution for their mistreatment is provided in the same manner as the original piece.
Sorry about that, Chief. You've just been shafted.
Once the final piece of the 1972 film wraps up, we are summarily returned to the catacombs and old crypts we started in, where the cryptkeeper drops the revelation that this wasn't what was to come, but what had already occurred.
You see, I wasn't warning you, but telling you why you are here. For all eternity.
What a twist!
Clues to this ending, such as Joan Collins' character wearing the brooch her husband had given her for Christmas just before she killed him, are sprinkled throughout the framing sequences, and the five are sent merrily on their way to hell. A sequel to this film was made in the year 1973, called The Vault of Horror, which will be coming up shortly here on the History of Comics on Film. Never mind the more famous HBO television series, which spawned several feature films.
Tales from the Crypt.
As to the 1972 Tales from the Crypt film, it really makes one appreciate the effectiveness it displays in making things horrific, yet without resorting to a great deal of gore, if any at all. With all the splatter gore and torture films out there these days, it's kind of refreshing to watch something that's more akin to an old episode of The Twilight Zone rather than, say, a film like High Tension. Also, it's no secret that the EC Comics also inspired my favorite horror anthology of all time, Creepshow, which also spawned a wonderfully penciled movie adaptation by Swamp Thing co-creator Bernie Wrightson. All in all, I have to say I'm a sucker for a good horror anthology flick, and while the 1972 film may not be as well known as the HBO series, that I often found it to be quite entertaining in its own right.
And now, who's next? Perhaps you?